Guys, we have a massive, massive problem on our hands in today's society. People are overweight. They're lethargic. They can't think. They have brain fog. Everything's going wrong. They're sick. They're struggling. And the reason is, it's easy. It's chronic stress. And the reason why chronic stress is such a big deal, and as if you guys heard me talk before, what happens when you're chronic stress? You have a chronic release of stress hormones, cortisol and noradrenaline. And what happens when you have these increase in the amount of stress hormones, boom, your blood pressure skyrockets because it wants available energy for the system. But what happens if you have a skyrocketing blood sugar? Well, what's gonna happen is you're gonna have a massive release of something called insulin. And so if this becomes chronic, we develop insulin resistance, where our cells cannot respond to insulin anymore because they're chronically elevated. It's like when your mom's chronically yelling at you, pretty soon you just tune her out. You know, you've really experimented that. So that's what we gotta figure out. And what happens when you have insulin resistance? Well, now, if the cells are not responsive to insulin, our blood sugar goes like this. And so what do you think happens when we're on that downslope of blood sugar? We have massive food cravings, because we want to replenish that blood sugar. And so what happens is a couple things. You get these sugar cravings, but also too, you lose massive amounts of muscle mass, because if we don't have available blood sugar, your body, your liver actually breaks down its own protein stores to turn into glucose and release back in the bloodstream. So it becomes this never-ending cycle. And what we're gonna do here is that we have to find a way to completely slash this entire process going on. And so if I had a solution that would increase brain function, that would never give us food cravings ever, especially sweets, and would just give us high energy for the entire day, would you be interested?
Yes.
I think so. And the answer, because I'm always looking for biological hacks to the system, natural hacks that we can utilize to speed up our and be our most efficient self possible and be the most productive possible. And so the solution to all this is something called ketones. Now, ketones, unlike glucose, ketones is a very clean energy source. I always call it the biodiesel for your body. It literally is. And so what happens is when you have this clean energy source of ketones flooding the system for our energy, we now have this steady source of energy, so we don't get food cravings because all our cells now have a steady, clean energy source. Now, the cool thing about ketones is that you've probably heard of the ketogenic diet. And the ketogenic diet is basically, when you're looking at this, it's a high fat, it's a moderate protein, and it's a low carbohydrate diet. And bear with me, because what I'm advocating here, I'm not advocating continuous ketosis throughout your entire life, because that's not sustainable. But I'm gonna tell you ways to hack the system to get the most benefit and most bang for your buck. But what's cool about a ketogenic diet, and if you read my book on intermittent fasting, is that a ketogenic diet mimics fasting physiology. The reason why fasting is so important is because when you're fasting, you actually diminish all your blood glucose and your glycogen stores. So then if you don't have that first go-to source of energy for your body, it's left to actually go after its stored fat, break its stored fat down into ketones, and use those for fuel. The problem is, hardly any of you guys have ever used ketones for fuel. It's an untapped energy source that no one ever uses, because if carbs are always present in our body, you're never gonna go after your ketone stores. And so what it is that you're using ketones instead of sugar. And ketosis, when you're measuring ketones in the blood, and you can do this on like urine strips, it really is about 0.5 to 0.8 millimolar. That's usually what ketosis is, and that's a measure of the ketones in your bloodstream. But you can do a simple one just by urine strips, very cheap. But the benefits of actually using ketones, getting our body to use ketones instead of glucose as energy, is numerous things. But the top two ones are its fat burning effect and your crazy increase in mental focus. And so for fat burning, you're gonna go after your stored and ingested fat as energy instead of the food you just put in your mouth. So you're actually gonna break down the visceral fat, the belly fat, and actually break that down into ketones, which is a form the body and the brain can use. And so just for weight loss alone, almost two and a half times more effective than severely restricting calories. And why does restricting calories not work? Everyone's tried it, everyone does it. Each and every New Year's, I'm gonna eat less and work out more. It doesn't work. And why? It's because if I restrict my caloric intake to say 1,000 calories a day, well, what happens is that your body senses that it's starving. And so it actually lowers its metabolism to equal 1,000 calories, whatever you're giving it. So if you're at a caloric net, you're not having any change, you're not gonna lose any weight. Because at first you will, right? At first, if you severely lower calories, you lose weight, but then it tapers off every time because all of a sudden your metabolism starts to tank. Well, it's not the case with ketosis. And also too, the increase in mental focus and clarity. Because here's the deal, if you give your body glucose and ketones at the same time, your brain will selectively go after the ketones and not the glucose. And why? Because it's a clean fuel. It produces a lot less free radicals, a lot less ROS, reactive oxygen species, very important. And so it's honestly, for me, when I do this, it's the first benefit I ever noticed was the crazy increase in mental clarity. You know, it's almost like you're just able to study for hours on end. You have that much energy. The problem is no one taps into this. No one's using this. Again, like I said, it's a clean fuel, less free radicals, but also too, kind of with the weight loss, but eliminates hunger cravings. Why? Because glucose is dependent on the food you eat. When you eat, your glucose goes up. But ketones, if you don't eat and you go through a fasting period, it actually stays elevated throughout the body at a consistent rate. So your body always has an energy source, so you don't have the food cravings. You don't have that drop in blood glucose, which all of a sudden signifies a massive craving for horrible foods that we end up regretting about 1 minute after we eat everything. And so, anti-cancer benefits. This is one of the biggest things. You know, a lot of research, and I actually did a talk on just the ketogenic diet and cancer, but cancer cells love glucose. They love blood sugar. You starve your body of blood sugar and you only use ketones as energy. Cancer cells don't have that metabolic flexibility. So literally when you're doing this, you're purging away any precancerous cells in the body. So you basically stay cancer free for life. Maintain and increase strength. Yeah, that's right. Actually limiting protein in your diet, you'll actually maintain or increase in strength, because when you're in ketosis and your body's using ketones as energy, it has a protein sparing effect. You keep your muscle mass on, so the sooner you can get into ketosis, the better, because it actually literally protects your body from any type of wasting. Anti-inflammatory, and this is cool. Why are so many elite athletes, why are all these elite cyclists now getting on this ketogenic diet? It's a fad now. I mean, everyone's doing it, and it's because these elite athletes notice that you can derive so much more energy per oxygen molecule than you can with just regular glucose metabolism. And so even divers, they're able to hold their breath almost twice as long when they're in ketosis versus not being in ketosis, because their body's a lot more efficient. Again, it's like that biodiesel. And so one of my favorite things, and one thing I really want to do, is I want to maximize brain functioning as much as possible. That's one that I'm really passionate about. And so when you're looking at just brain benefits alone of utilizing ketones as fuel, you're talking, again, a clean fuel, superior fuel for the brain. Again, your brain will rather go after ketones instead of glucose. Less free radicals. And this is cool, beta-hydroxybutyrate. It's one of the ketone bodies that's formed. It actually can change your DNA expression for the better. Because our genome, our human genome, has not changed in 10,000 years. That's the one constant we always have. In fact, in the 1950s, when chronic disease started increasing big time, doctors want to blame it on your genes. Well, the genes have not changed, but your expression of your genes can change, and that's based on the environment that you put yourself surrounding. So if you have an unhealthy environment, if you're exposed to a chronically unhealthy environment, you're going to express more unhealthy genes. Not different genes, just different parts of the same genome that's never changed. And it's a G protein receptor activator, so it causes a huge anti-inflammatory reaction in the body, in the brain, which is why a ketogenic diet reverses Alzheimer's disease. Really does. And then BDNF, it activates brain-derived neurotrophic factor, along with intermittent fasting. And brain-derived neurotrophic factor, when you activate this thing, it then in turn activates all your brain stem cells. So you've heard of probably neuroplasticity. That's the making of new brain cells. Well, this is how you do it right here. Intermittent fasting and ketosis. And so David Perlmutter, Dr. Perlmutter, he wrote Grain Brain. You might have heard of that book before. He's a neurologist. He says this about ketones, and remember, beta hydroxybutyrate is a ketone. Ketones are an epigenetic player. It actually has huge effects on the expression of your DNA. When you're in mild ketosis, which is what I'm going to be advocating in a second, your body is availing itself now to this chemical. It stimulates changes in the expression of your DNA, which is positive, reducing inflammation, increasing detoxification pathways, and increasing your body's antioxidant production. This stuff is nothing short of amazing. It's a great biological hack that each and every one of you can do. And so, how does it work? Again, when your body needs energy, it first goes after its blood sugar. And once the blood sugar is gone, it goes after its glycogen stores. You have glycogen in your liver and your muscle. And glycogen is kind of stored glucose in those areas, just in case. Once you utilize your blood sugar and glycogen, then your body has to go after ketones, that clean energy. And so, but it only works if we eliminate the glycogen and the blood sugar. And that only happens if we do intermittent fasting and allow ourselves to take a break from the carbs or ketosis. And so here's the deal. With the ketogenic diet, getting real specific here and looking at the nutrient breakdown, you're talking around 70 to 80%. We're just gonna simplify it. 70% of your calories should be from fat. It sounds easy. Oh, I gotta eat a lot of fat. It's not that easy, because the kicker is it's moderate levels of protein. And this is gonna be a lot lower amount of protein than you're gonna be used to having. So you're talking 15 to 20% protein and about 10% carbohydrates. Now, if you're looking for foods to eat, an example of how to incorporate it right now is, here's some example foods. Healthy oils, olive oil, coconut oil, you know, even coconuts, olives. You're talking just healthy cheese, grass-fed butter, nuts and seeds, pasteurized eggs, healthy meats, wild fish, avocados, and low-carb veggies. And this is why this can be so tough to incorporate continuously, because you even have restrictions on root vegetables. So there are certain vegetables, obviously potatoes, but it's so restrictive because here are the things you have to avoid. And just look at that. Fruit, you have to avoid. You have to avoid root vegetables like we talked about. Grains, starches, obviously. Beans, low-fat foods, a lot of the sauces and condiments that you use. Unhealthy fats, obviously, and also milk. So a healthy cream used a little bit and butter is fine, but milk has way too many carbohydrates that will knock you out of ketosis just like that. So it's restrictive. It's very, very difficult to do this long term. And so a sample meal plan of actually doing a ketogenic diet will kind of look like this. Here's like a breakfast, lunch, and dinner. I know it's kind of small, but you're looking at things like eggs and bacon, but using, and you're actually making your spinach and everything out of the bacon grease. You gotta add those kind of, I call them fat bombs, to almost every meal you use, because you gotta make sure you're getting at least 70% of your calories from fat. Lunch, you can have a chicken salad, but it's not just chicken and some lettuce. It's chicken and spinach. You add some olive oil, some healthy feta cheese or blue cheese. You're gonna add some peppers, arugula, kale, because all greens are good for this diet. And then dinner, you're talking pork chops with, you know, again, you're always adding a fat bomb, like olive oil, coconut oil, you know, anything like that. And so that's just a sample meal plan. There's many out there. You can just Google sample ketogenic meal plans and you're gonna get a ton. And sample snacks that you can kind of snack on throughout the day. My favorite is avocado and macadamia nuts. And macadamia nuts are huge because they already by nature have a very low protein content for the nut. Instead of versus like almonds and stuff like that have higher protein. So it's way easier to get those nutrient ratios. And in just a second, we're actually going to go over examples on how to calculate your nutrient ratios out of what you're eating. But bone broth is going to be huge. Avocados, like I just mentioned. But this is what we're used to eating. And if it's not that, you know, you might be eating a whole grain pasta or something like that. But it's still the same stuff. We're used to eating a lot of refined or just general carbohydrates. And so the problem with that is that if we always have these carbs present in our system, we're never gonna go after the ketones. So this takes practice. We have to utilize this and actually get your body to change its metabolism into a different energy source. And it takes patience and it takes practice. And so again, even though carbs are always present, or should I say this, even though your fat, even though we have an enormous supply of fat, we're unable to utilize this fat as fuel. Think of a big like oil tanker going around and then it runs out of gas. Even though it has a ton of oil it's carrying, it can still actually run out of gas. That's kind of the same with our bodies. Even though we may have an enormous amount of fat on our bodies, we're not able to use that fuel as energy, even though we have an enormous supply of it. It's been a problem. We got to change that. And so here are really the four ways to get into ketosis. Intermittent fasting is the first one, and that's the key. In fact, where ketogenic diets were actually invented was from Johns Hopkins Hospital for people under medicine-resistant seizures. And the first protocol they use to get into ketosis is intermittent fasting. It's the first thing they do, because when you give your body a break from eating these foods with protein and carbohydrates, it forces your body to rid itself of glycogen and blood sugar and utilize ketones. It's the easiest way to get in there. And then diet, obviously following the ketogenic diet. And also there's something called, and it's kind of popular now in the market, it's exogenous ketones. Exogenous means from an outside source. It's basically ketones in a supplement form that you can actually take to actually give your body, flood your body with ketones, and it actually allows you to go into ketosis a lot faster. So it's another kind of hack to the system. Now, I'm still kind of experimenting and struggling with this idea because I don't like to do a whole lot of things that are unnatural to normal human physiology. This hack does work. There's just not a whole lot of studies on long-term efficacy of ketones taken from an outside source, putting it in the body. So that's kind of left unsolved, but that's a possibility. So when you're implementing this, there's two ways you can do it. You can do a continuous ketosis where you're constantly following the ketogenic diet all hours of the day for multiple years. You're gonna reap many benefits, but it's hard. Or you can do what I do and you can cycle through mild ketosis. Because here's the deal, you don't need to get into full-blown clinical ketosis to get these benefits. We just gotta start using some ketones as fuel. We don't need to get in that clinical state, but we just need to use some. So we need to have that metabolic flexibility. Because think about this, our ancestors did this all the time. They were without food, they'd be going hunting for days on end without food. So they're hunting in a starving state. They're in full-blown ketosis. Why do they have so much energy when they're hunting? Because they've had no food. They're in ketosis, so they have that steady state of energy, that mental clarity, so they can actually successfully hunt game, kill them, and eat. And so this has been around for entire human existence, but we're just not utilizing it anymore because we have food available everywhere. Just this block alone probably has 20, 30, 40 restaurants. Never was like that in the case. So cycling, this is what I believe. Now, like I said, remaining in it may be ill-advised because you have to avoid fruit. I don't think it's very, I don't think that's a very safe strategy nor an effective strategy to really eliminate fruit from your diet your entire life. I don't really find that not only palatable, but I don't find that actually as a safe intervention. So I like the cycling. And also too, these prebiotic fiber-rich carbs, things like bananas, things like root vegetables that actually feed healthy bacteria in your system. If you're gonna follow a ketogenic diet continuously, you're gonna be devoid of all of those. And so you might have some gut issues going on. You may have some other problems, but I just think that we're meant to have all these fruits and all these root vegetables in our diet. We just might have to cycle through it. And so this is what I recommend. If none of you guys have actually gotten into clinical ketosis, you first have to do it. And so you actually first have to put in the hard work. It takes on average about a week or two to get into full-blown ketosis. So that means intermittent fasting and eating on a ketogenic diet on the foods we just discussed. After you're able to actually get that flexibility and get into ketosis, again, it takes about 1 to 2 weeks, then I recommend just doing intermittent fasting for the rest of the time. Because when you intermittent fast, after you've gone into ketosis, it's kind of like your body kind of has this muscle memory. Once you're able to get into ketosis initially, it's a lot easier to get into it in your subsequent times. But if you've never gotten into it, even if you intermittent fast, you're not gonna get into it. So first you do a 1 to 2 week ketogenic diet. And the only way you stop that is if you test your blood levels and make sure you're actually in ketosis, which is gonna be about a little bit over 0.8 millimolar. Now I'll show you the test strips I use personally, so we're gonna show you all of this. But after that, you just do a daily intermittent fast. But also too, once we're in that daily intermittent fast, I recommend 1 to 2 times per month doing a 3-day full-on out ketosis ketogenic diet, just 3 days. And so me and my wife actually just got done with one of those last week. But it's just another way to kind of reset the system, get that in there. So a 1 3-day fast, I put 1 to 2, but just start off with 1 3-day ketogenic diet, and then the rest you're gonna do intermittent fasting every day. And I'm gonna show you how that all works in a second. And when you're doing, for example, let's say you're doing the first 2 week ketogenic diet, if you've never gotten into it before, that's the first step, you gotta do it. You may consider exogenous ketones, those ketones from an outside source, because it's gonna allow you to get into that state faster. Because here's the deal, transitioning, getting on a ketogenic diet, you're on that for about a week and a half before you get into ketosis. But that transition state, you're not gonna be feeling good. You're not gonna have any of those benefits that ketosis offers because we haven't gotten there yet. But that transition, that initial transition takes a while. So instead of having that mental focus that ketosis brings, you're gonna have that mental unfocus. You're gonna be lethargic. You're just gonna be like, need caffeine bombs every second. So it's difficult. And so a hack for that is exogenous ketones, and that's almost available everywhere now. And so daily IF, like I said, and so here's how you can measure it at first. Has anyone actually been into official clinical ketosis here? One. You?
I think I had two.
You think? Did you test it?
No, but I was on it for a very long time.
You were? Okay, 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 cool. So two out of 25? It is. The Atkins diet, though, is high protein. And guess what happens when you have excess protein? It gets converted to glucose, takes you out of ketosis right away. So they're very similar in the fact that they're both high fat and low carb, but the protein's a big difference. And so here, I know this is small, but fat has 9 calories per gram. Carbohydrates and protein have 4 calories per gram. So let's look at this nutrition label. Say we're going on this full-on ketogenic diet and we're looking at this label. Well, the first thing you're gonna notice on the very left-hand side is you're gonna see this total amount of calories in this food is 160. Can you see that? Good. So 160 calories. Fat has 15 grams. So what you're gonna do is you're gonna take 15 grams, multiply that by 9 calories per gram to see how much calories from fat is in that food. And in this example, it's 135. So to find out the percentage of calories of fat, you take the 135 divided by 160, the total amount of calories, and we're left with 84% fat. So this food right here, as an example, is an 84% fat. Well, obviously in a ketogenic diet, we want to average around 70 to 80%. So that's very close. And this is just one food, for example. You're gonna have to average every single thing out. And I recommend you actually do this for the first at least couple days so you actually know if it's working. Because if you're just kind of experimenting around and you don't really know if you're hitting the right ratios, you're basically putting yourself through a lot of hard work, in most cases for nothing, because you'll be surprised at what your macros are actually at. So it does take a couple, you know, calculations, a little division, multiplication, but it's worth it because I don't want you guys to go through hard work for no reason. And so again, carbs, 4 grams times 4 calories per gram, you got 16 calories that are in the form of carbohydrates. So you take the 16 divided by 160 equals 10% of this food is carbohydrates. Does that make sense? And it's the same thing with protein. And if anyone has any questions about that math, I'll explain it to you after. But that's how you know. And so you're gonna do this with every single food for the day, and you're gonna make sure that you're in that 70 to 80% of your calories as fat, about 5 to 10% of your calories as carbohydrates, and about 20% for protein. It's very important you hit those exact macros. And so, if you're wondering if you're in ketosis, well, here's a couple signs that you know for sure that you're in ketosis. And number one is you'll notice your breath is kind of turning, some people say fruity breath. Mm-hmm. I don't really find it fruity. I find it interesting. You'll notice, it's not hard to notice. So you're like, okay, that's different. You know, this fruity, I think, is kind of a, it's making it sound too good to be true. It's not that, the breath is not that great component, but usually that breath, that partial of the bad breath subsides as you're in it for longer. But at first you're gonna notice some breath changes. Most people, you're gonna notice massive amounts of mental clarity once you're in ketosis. So you'll know that for sure. It's very, very obvious. Weight loss, you're gonna notice weight's coming down, your hunger cravings are going away. And also too, an easy one, you're gonna notice that you have increased ketones in the body by the urine strips. Now they have blood tests, they have these finger prick things. The urine strips are the easiest ones to do, so that's what I advocate. They also have these breathalyzer ones that measure the acetone in your breath. Again, those are a little bit more expensive, so the urine strips work just fine. And so, an example, and here's just an example of how keto is so sensitive. One chicken breast that you eat will completely kick you out of ketosis right away. It's that easy. But the thing is, a chicken breast with the green salad, topped with a ton of olive oil, you know, and you've got some blue cheese and you add it with the Bulletproof coffee, which is coffee with healthy fats in it, that'll keep you in ketosis. And almost all my nutrition talks where I advocate a high fat diet and my ketogenic talks even, I just get these, you know, massive amounts of vegan haters, if you will, just commenting on all over my videos. But a lot of vegans do ketogenic diets too. This is not exclusive to carnivores. Vegans can do the same thing. For example, you know, I could do a separate talk on just vegans and ketogenic diet, but they can easily take this type of protein, which is what I recommend for vegans, MRM, Veggie Elite Performance Protein. You add that with coconut milk, a half of avocado, you have some MCT oil, which is medium chain fatty acid oil. And again, that hits your macros right there. So vegans do this, and they do see major benefits. So this is not exclusive to people who eat meat, by no means. And again, you're only eating moderate levels of protein anyway, so it's very, very subtle. And this is what I use at home. This is the urine test strip. So you pretty much just pee on it and you measure the color. You just wait for a couple seconds and then you see where you're at and it'll give you the proper amount. And again, to get into full-on ketosis, you want to get at least 0.8 millimolar. And you'll see that kind of number on your test strips, but it's very important to do that. And if you're not there, make sure you add more of those fat bombs. And the fat bombs I like is the MCT oil. You can buy that at any health food store. MCT oil, coconut oil is an MCT oil. It's a medium chain fat, but coconut oil it's more of in its natural state. So I do a lot of coconut oil, but MCT oil is fantastic. Extra virgin olive oil, grass-fed butter, all of those are good ways to get healthy fats in every meal. And so this is what I do, and this is basically my typical day. So I start off by having Bulletproof coffee. So it gives me caffeine and it gives me these medium chain fats. Turns out that caffeine actually stimulates ketosis in the body. It actually upregulates that process. So caffeine is good. For those of you that don't use caffeine, you can do these fat bombs in tea as well. You can add like some butter in tea. To me, that doesn't sound very appetizing, but hey, go for it if you don't need caffeine, or do decaf or something like that. But caffeine actually does help you get into ketosis. And then I do a lot of hydration and a lot of movement right when I get up in the morning. And then this is very similar to my typical day, but think about it. I haven't eaten since the night before. So I go through 8 hours at nighttime while I'm sleeping. I get up in the morning at around 5 a.m. on average. I have my Bulletproof coffee with the fat bombs. I'm staying real hydrated to about 12 to 12:30, and that's after I have my first meal. So I'm literally going over 16 hours without eating. So not only am I going through all my glycogen and my blood glucose stores, but also too, I'm adding these healthy fats in my system that rapidly can get converted to ketones, and I'm staying hydrated, and it's an easy way to get in that mild state of ketosis. So this is like what's gonna be an example of your typical day. This is my example, from your dinner at night to your first meal the next day. Now, if you're gonna do this, say you're going on you're gonna incorporate that ketogenic diet for the first time, and you're actually gonna get into that state of ketosis for the first time. Well, when you start, the night before, you wanna have a low carb dinner, and really what you're gonna do is you're gonna do the same thing. You're gonna do a low carb dinner, you're gonna start your morning off like this, and then the only difference is that the meals at lunch and dinner have to be completely ketogenic. Mine aren't, because I'm getting into ketosis in the morning, and then I have healthy carbohydrates in the form of fruits and stuff like that at afternoon and at night. So I'm kind of cycling in and out of ketosis, so I have that metabolic flexibility now. But I've already put my body through this 2-week period of ketogenic dieting, so I already know I have the metabolic flexibility to do that. So you guys gotta do that first. Now, this is the coffee I do. And so I just do black organic coffee. I brew it fresh, grind the beans every morning. I add about a tablespoon of coconut oil or MCT oil and grass-fed butter with a pinch of cinnamon, blend it up in a blender, and that's my Bulletproof coffee. If you haven't tried it, it's literally amazing. It tastes like just a beautiful foamy latte or something like that. I don't know, but it's awesome. And again, as an option, especially if you're going through these longer ketogenic diets, if you will, those 1 or 2 week one or the 3 day one I advocate once a month, I would add exogenous ketones so you can get to that state faster, because the faster you get in the state, the faster you reap those benefits. Now, these are the exogenous ketones that I've personally experienced with already. And it's cool because even as like a pre-workout supplement, right before I go to the gym, I'll take a little bit of exogenous ketones, just experimenting around, and the energy is amazing that you get from this. It's not caffeine, it's just literally an alternate energy source rather than blood glucose and glycogen. And so these are the ones I've experienced with. So those are the main ones that I know of. Keto Sports is a brand, and Prove It's a brand. If you guys been to Cal Jam a couple weekends ago, I know I see a few familiar faces. They've had these stands out there because they are, I mean, it's catching on right now. And so the big side effect, like I said, getting into ketosis is awesome. That transition is not awesome. And a lot of people experience something called the keto flu. And the keto flu is kind of where you're transitioning, like I said, but you feel like this lethargic. You have hunger cravings. Your body doesn't know what to, it's kind of a period of unresponse. And when you're on a ketogenic diet, a lot of times we're deficient in certain electrolytes and minerals, potassium, sodium, and magnesium. So that's where your bone broth is gonna come in very handy, because it's high in all three of those things. So if you have a steady influx of bone broth each and every day while you're on this, you're easily gonna combat those nutrient deficiencies. So you're gonna basically reduce the amount of keto flu you have so you don't even get it. But that's really what it comes down to, is because you're deficient in those three nutrients, the potassium, sodium, and magnesium. And again, bone broth, but also too, avocados are a huge magnesium powerhouse. So doing avocados, which I do about two a day anyway, are gonna be amazing for when you're on the ketogenic diet and avoiding this state here. And as a warning, if you're on high blood pressure medication and you're going on a ketogenic diet, you need to be in close contact with your doctor modifying your dose, because what's gonna happen is that you're gonna normalize that blood pressure quickly. And so if you're taking a high blood pressure drug and all of a sudden you normalize your own physiological blood pressure, well then it's gonna be dropping too low because you're constantly taking this pill that even lowers it even more. So you wanna monitor, so you're constantly giving them your readings so we can basically alter your dose based on whatever it is. So you wanna make sure that happens. Now, also too, I want to mention that your blood work, and this is, I got this information from Dominic D'Agostino. He's the professor in the Department of Molecular Pharmacology and Physiology. He says, when you look at blood work, sometimes you're going to see an increase in LDL cholesterol, but that's really nothing to worry about. And the reason why is because the LDLs that are increasing is the larger LDLs. The smaller ones are actually decreasing. But if you have the larger ones increasing and the smaller ones decreasing, the net amount of LDL is actually greater. But really what's linked to any type of heart disease is those really small LDL particles. So it's special blood tests you do to actually get more accurate. And if the LDL is the only thing you see raise in your blood work, then you're completely fine. The only thing you want to worry about is if you see things like your homocysteine raising, your C-reactive protein, which is a sign of inflammation, if you see that increasing, then you may want to kind of worry and maybe modify a few things. Because most of the time, if you're doing excessive amounts of dairy, like an excessive amount of cheese, because it's easy to eat a ridiculous amount of cheese and stay in ketosis. It's very, very easy. But I'm not advocating that. You know, I do have healthy cheese, but some. I'm not taking a whole, you know, freaking stick of cheese and just munching on that all day. But even if I was, you'd actually still technically hit ketosis still, but a lot of that cheese components will actually raise your C-reactive proteins, inflammation in the body, so you just wanna be wary of that. If you kinda see those blood markers going up, eliminate more of the cheeses and the other dairy you're taking. These figures here, in 1900, 1 in 20, this is the incidence of cancer. So you can see here that even though we've done massive technological advances in cancer research, all this stuff, we're constantly giving money to this purple ribbon, pink ribbon stuff, you're still seeing this trend. 1 in 20, 1940, 40 years later, 1 in 16, 1 in 10, now it's 1 in 3 people get cancer. So this is a big business, but they're not focusing on prevention. But think about if they knew the stuff about the ketogenic diet and actually knew that cancer cells can't get their energy from ketones. It would be a game changer. But these effective things, these guys want to look the other way because they're not going to get any profit from this. They're making massive amounts of profit off the radiation, the chemo, the surgeries, the breast removal. All that stuff is money in the bank for this business. It's a big, big business. And so, again, when you're looking at the difference between healthy cells and cancer cells, the cancer cells have that built-in fatal flaw. They can't get their energy effectively through ketones. So as long as what most people do, have a nice steady influx of refined carbohydrates, those cancer cells are so happy and they're just going to thrive in that environment. It's a never-ending cycle. And this is the fact of the matter. If you're over 40 and don't smoke, there's an 80% chance you'll die from one of four diseases: cancer, stroke, Alzheimer's, and heart disease. 80% chance. Now, here, Dr. Thomas Seyfried, this is what he says: calorie restriction and restricted ketogenic diets, basically saying intermittent fasting and ketogenic diets, which reduce circulating glucose levels, your blood sugar, obviously, and elevate ketone levels, is anti-invasive, anti-angiogenic. Angiogenic is cancer, and pro-apoptotic. It actually kills cancer cells dead in its tracks. So we know this, but they're not utilizing this. And here's the thing. Carbs turn into glucose, which feed all your cells, your healthy and your cancer cells. You rid yourself of that glucose and you feed it instead this really clean, beautiful energy source called ketones. Well, ketones then are gonna not only starve your cancer cells, but it's gonna allow all your other cells to absolutely thrive, most notably your brain. And that's why you get this major increase in focus. And metformin, the diabetes drug that actually lowers circulating glucose levels, hence lowers insulin. If you lower glucose levels, you're more likely to increase ketones, which is why metformin is actually shown to decrease the incidence of cancer. That's one of the things that's actually shown. Now, it does have side effects like any other drug, like destroying your mitochondria, but that's cool. But I mean, at least it's shown that, and that's why, because it actually lowers your blood glucose levels, which doesn't give the available amounts of food for your cancer cells to feed off of. And so you would think that knowing all this, today's cancer conditions, these clinics, you know, these most advanced clinics in the world would actually utilize this stuff, right? You know, let's take a look at cancer clinics. You know, they got their radiation, chemo, and let's see what kind of food they provide their people. Oh, yeah, the surgeons themselves eat McDonald's, that's cool. But it wouldn't be complete without Dunkin' Donuts, you know, and they have this, and you see this stuff that they're eating. They're freaking and giving them Jell-O and like applesauce. I mean, it's just a joke. It's such a joke. Not to mention, if they get a visitor and they want to take them for a walk, oh, let's get a donut, you know, it's right there in the cancer clinic that actually feeds cancer cells. It's just so counterintuitive. And so when you're looking at this, is it a good business model? Absolutely. We're going to actually feed you things that are, that basically cause this disease that you're in here for the first place. Like, this is an amazing business model. Patient outcomes, it is devastating. It actually is just killing more and more people. And it's no surprising that today we're 1 in 3 have cancer. So ketogenic diets, it's kind of confusing. But again, if you're new to it, first start off, get into ketosis right away. So you're going to do that 1 to 2 week period. And then you're just going to go into that daily intermittent fasting where you, what I think is most convenient, just skipping breakfast. You're allowing your body to kind of cycle through using ketones as energy. And then you're going to have healthy fruit, you know, towards lunch and dinner. Have some quinoa even. Oh my gosh. Sprouted bread. That's okay, because you're cycling through this and you're still reaping all those benefits. And then a 3-day period once a month, you're just doing the full ketogenic diet. And that's really all it is. But you're going to biologically hack that body and get it to be its best self possible and reap all the benefits that we discuss. Questions? Yeah. Yeah, almost everyone does.
So, this will take you out of that, and then what happens after that?
Well, when you have insulin resistance, when your cells stop responding to insulin, it's because you don't, what caused that in the first place is you didn't have a synergy source, because your blood glucose is going up and down, causing massive cravings. And so, by introducing ketones to the body, first of all, if your mom is yelling at you constantly, you start to tune it out. But how is she going to be effective if she stops for a little bit and then comes back at you again? Because you've had a little period of quiet time, and then boom, so she changed it up a little bit. Well, it's the same thing. If your insulin's chronically elevated, well, guess what? Eliminating those carbs and doing intermittent fasting is going to decrease insulin, because it no longer needs to be elevated anymore. And that's the only way to actually fix it in the first place. So you're an example of someone that actually has to be on this if you want perfect health.
And then the other thing is, when I was on Atkins a long time ago, and I was, you know, they told me, oh, you shouldn't be doing this because it's bad for your kidneys. Does that affect your kidneys?
Well, thing is, a lot of people, when they're on the Atkins diet, you know, when you see the foods I recommend, it's all healthy stuff. You know, when what happened to people on Atkins, they were literally buying these, I mean, at least I saw some people, they'd buy like big old pizzas and just take the toppings off and eat that, you know, and like throw away the bread. So they're doing things like not necessarily were like important, but a lot of times too, they weren't really following the Atkins to the dead tea too, because Atkins diet actually is a very good diet. It just has higher protein than you should. And so when you're going through these changes, I mean, in rare cases, it can do stuff to the kidneys, but honestly, so many people have had success with that. And it's because you're drastically lowering blood glucose levels.
When you talk about intermittent fasting, mm-hmm. can you explain exactly what that is?
Yeah, so intermittent fasting, so continuous fasting has a ton of benefits. It's not really a coincidence why almost every single religion in the world has to do with some type of fast, regardless of what religion it is. A lot of people practice these long-term fasts going on, you know, Lent, Ramadan, whatever. But intermittent fasting is where you restrict your eating window every day. So instead of doing what you're told by the nutritionist or whoever told you to eat every 2.5 to 3 hours, starting with a fresh big breakfast right when you get up, because it's the most important meal of the day, and then eating every 2.5, 3 hours, end on end, throughout the entire day, you're constantly replenishing blood glucose and blood sugar. And if that's always there, you're never gonna go after your fat stores and turn that into ketones to use. And so what I'm recommending is restricting your eating window. Instead of eating 16 hours out of the day all the time, you're gonna restrict it. Most commonly, it's the 16-8 method, where you fast for 16 hours, you eat for a period of 8 hours. So for example, for me, I eat around 12 to 8. On days I'm off work, I usually actually have it a lot more narrow. But so 12 o'clock, right at lunchtime is my first meal, dinner is my last meal. So I'm eating for 8 hours, and then for the rest of the 16 hours part of that day, I'm not eating anything. And so that's basically what it is. You're just basically skipping one meal. And so it's not the end of the world. You don't have major food choices or food guides that actually you have to do during the eating window. It's just skipping one meal and eating it all in the small window. And what you're gonna find too is that it's actually hard to eat that same amount in a shorter window. You know, because you gotta add another full meal in there to eat like what you once did. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so in that way too, it helps with weight loss, but.
Do you have any handouts on
the menu? Yeah, I mean, I had several talks, my book's right there on intermittent fasting. Yeah,
okay.
Yeah. I take them with food. So I take them with my first smoothie. That's my first meal of the day after my workout, because I do a fasted workout to get the most physiological benefits to my body. And then I make a power smoothie, very similar to the ones we give you with the superfoods. And I take my supplements with that. Yeah, I don't like taking my supplements at an empty stomach. And I do them all at once to simplify my schedule. Yep. Any other questions? Yeah.
So you start with the urine strips right away.
Yeah, because if you've never gotten to ketosis, that's the only way to know.
Okay.
Yeah. And again, if you're doing it like the old school way where you're not using any exogenous ketones, you're going to have that initial transition period. But a lot of big changes that you make are going to have a transition period. If you quit drinking coffee, you're going to go through this kind of caffeine withdrawal, and you're going to go through a weak transition. So a lot of these big changes will require that. But if you use exogenous ketones, you'll cut that in at least half.